This is a National Arts Center podcast.
Hello. Welcome to Insights, a series of thought-provoking discussions that feature leaders in arts, science, and technology. Arts, Medicine, and Life is hosted by award-winning medical educator Dr. Jillian Horton, that features doctors and artists speaking about their area of interest and expertise. Thank you to Scotiabank, MD Financial Management, and the Canadian Medical Association for their generous support of this podcast. This episode was recorded live online due to the recent pandemic. Sue Goyette is an author and has published a novel and 8 collections of poetry. Her work has been translated into German, French, and Spanish, and has won many awards for her writing, including the CBC Literary Award for Poetry, the Earle Birney Award, the Bliss Carman Poetry Award, the Pat Lowther Award, the Atlantic Independent Booksellers Choice Award, the ReLit Award, J.M. Abraham Poetry Awards, and a National Magazine Award, Lieutenant Governor Nova Scotia Masterworks Arts Award, and has been a finalist for the Griffin Poetry Prize. Sue teaches in the Creative Writing Program at Dalhousie University and is the current Poet Laureate for the City of Halifax. She joined Dr. Horton to talk about poetry, language, humanism, and mindfulness, and how the artistic process could be adapted by medical professionals as an added tool in their approach to their practice. Let's listen in.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Jillian Horton, and I am the host of Arts, Medicine, Life, a series currently on the virtual stage at the National Arts Center. I am so grateful to the series hosts who make this show possible, the Canadian Medical Association, Scotiabank, and MD Management. Arts, Medicine, Life is a series where we have the opportunity to explore in depth some of the intersections between the medical arts and the arts in general. And this evening, I have the great pleasure of hosting poet Sue Goyette. Sue comes to us from Halifax today, where she is the Poet Laureate. She's written at least 8 books of poetry, as well as a novel. She's received multiple awards for her work that spans themes and genres. And she is currently a teacher of creative writing at Dalhousie University. Sue, I'm so grateful that you could be here with us today. Welcome and thank you.
This is such a delight. Thank you for having me, Jillian. I'm looking forward to this conversation.
Me too. So I'm going to start with a question about your journey, because I know exactly how a person becomes a physician, but even though I'm a writer, I'm a little less certain how a person creates a path to becoming a poet. So I wonder if you could talk a bit, Sue, about your journey and how you ended up doing the work that you do.
How did I come to be a poet? Well, first of all, I always have loved words. I was a reader when I was young, and I also was a pretty keen observer. And so I always check things out and notice things. I would see the bugs on plants that no one would see outside. And I also liked listening to people talk. I was really into language and reading. And I also was pretty operatic. I lived in a hard house. It wasn't easy. And there were a lot of things I just wanted to export from myself and put onto paper. And I think I started leaning into poetry almost right away, just because I really liked ending the line when I felt like it needed to end rather than right across the page. And so without even knowing, I was writing poems pretty young. And then once I started high school and things became dramatic in the way they do when you're an adolescent, I wrote fiery breakup poems about people, and one got published in the school newspaper. And wasn't so much the getting the publication that started me thinking that I'd want to write, but the conversations I had afterwards when people had read the poem and could relate to it. I was really interested in that. So I've always kind of off-gassed a lot, and I off-gas in words. So that's how I started.
So tell me a little bit right now about what your day-to-day life looks like as a writer, as a creative person, and perhaps also layered in with the pandemic. What is your kind of ebb and flow from day-to-day, week-to-week? What is that experience like for you?
Well, I think like all of us, we're enduring a very, very challenging time that is ongoing in its challenges. And I think it's no small thing what we're living through. We're living in a very intense time. And so it takes great discipline for me to sustain a creative practice when I'm so easily distractible. And I think I'm distractible because I think I think we're all kind of being collectively traumatized by what's going on in the world. So I get up in the morning and I just try to write something, even a sentence, just something, so that that part of me and how I am when I write is being nourished or watered or however you want to think about it. And so I try to do that daily. I'm not always doing it daily, but that's my goal, is to do it daily. I try to pay attention and stay alert, because I think that in challenging the kinds of times we're in, like this challenging time, is when art is so important. And so all the years I've written with, you know, just like the kind of, you know, daily drama of life, of my life, or the things I'm thinking about are valid. But now there's something collectively going on. And I think that the discipline I have in place, and I've had in place for 40 years, is really a helpful thing to have for me, because I can rely on it and I can transform how and what I'm feeling into something else, and therefore process it and see it from different angles and even imagine it in a different way. And I think we're right at the edge of our, of knowing, like, this is a masterclass, this pandemic, of moving forward without knowing what's going to happen, which is kind of what writing poetry is. So I feel like I know this feeling of not knowing what's going to happen and doing it anyway. And so I'm even applying that poetics, or the way, that practice, to just how I go out into the world to do groceries right now.
Now, there's something interesting, I think, for a lot of people when they hear that you're a poet. There's something kind of mystical about it. You know, it has this sense of being a person who translates experience in a particular way, with a particular skill and a particular vision, in a sense. And I wonder if you could talk, for people who feel intimidated when they hear that someone is a poet, how can anyone make poetry accessible to themselves? How do you sort of invite people to begin that journey?
Yeah, I think poetry hasn't been served in how we've taught it. Like, I think we've been given the idea that we need a decoder ring, or there's a secret message in it, and if we don't get it, we don't get it. So many of us felt outside of the poems we encountered in school, where we mostly encountered poems. But I think there's a difference between a poem and being a poet in the world. And I think a poem is just like, you know, the great Leonard Cohen said, is just ash from the fire. But how we are when we write poems, I think, is really, really interesting and really important for how we're using the language that we use every day to, you know, order our coffee, you know, talk to our kids at supper, the same words, but we're trying to put them in sequences or a syntax that re-engages those words in unexpected ways. And so when I write a poem, I'm not just thinking of the words I'm using, because what we're after when we're writing poems is what can't be said. You know, the things that we don't have words for, those experiences that are transformative or big or unexpected and surprising. And so I'm trying to get to the edge of, as close as I can to that unsayable, and make it as hospitable as I can to the reader. And my job is to create kind of a poem, which is like a space, like a location or experience for the reader to move through. And hopefully, if they've moved through the poem, at the end of it, they'll feel changed or different somehow, or they've encountered something they didn't expect. And it's more about being okay with starting to read something you don't understand and doing it anyway, which I think is really good for all of us, and getting to the end and maybe being surprised because you didn't expect it, but being open to whatever happens. I tell my students, it's a lot like moving through a car wash. You're just going through something. It's an actual experience or an event, reading a poem, and you're not looking for clues or solving a mystery. What you're doing is feeling the experience of moving through the poem, and your response and understanding of it is just as valid as someone who teaches literature in university. It's just as valid. So for people who are interested in writing, you know, just kind of having a practice where they're using words as the medium rather than paint or, you know, their body as movement, dance, I would suggest people just start noticing things in their day to day. So, you know, like we all know Oprah's, you know, list 5 things you're grateful for. I invite people when I do workshops just to start noticing 5 things in your day, even if it's like how the light is falling on the magnolia that's just opened, or how the cat is playing the piano and what the cat is trying to communicate. Just noticing, and how you're noticing, and listing like 5 things. Even I got students this year to describe clouds every day, like just to go out and look at clouds and try to describe them, because they're beguiling. Like, how do we describe a cloud? Like, we often say it's like that, but it's kind of a great challenge. But it's more just having a set practice, even like I said, five things every day. And what begins to happen is, you know, the more you look, the more you see, first of all. And when you know you're going to have to like write five things the next day, you start observing more because you know you've got to write something the next day. So you start composing and your day becomes, it changes your day. And so what I love about teaching writing and poetry, I teach poetry, I don't teach fiction, but poetry is how you are in your days when you are on the lookout for things that are unexpected, how you change and how you impact people you meet, because you're in that space of being vital and awake and alert and curious. And so the conversations you have will be vital in that way, which I think is really interesting. So in a way, it's as it can be as it's like a pandemic of creativity, if we wanted to think of it that way, where how we should we become into our days creatively is something we share and ignite in each other. And I know that sounds like I'm woohoo poetry, but I actually am, because I think any kind of creative practice, I think, is really healthy for us, as you know. So
there are so many things you just said that I love. And a couple of things jump out at me. The first one is the relationship between, you know, that noticing, that constant practice of paying attention and mindfulness. You know, these are things that we know on the medical side and the neuroscience side, as you said, they not only change what we notice, but they actually change our brain. I mean, we rewire a little bit based on developing those practices. So there's such a note of hopefulness there. But the second thing that you said that I'd really like to talk about a little bit more is this idea, you know, the validity of anyone's experience, reading, writing, interpretation. I think this is often something about, it's probably true of all healthcare workers, but physicians in particular don't like to feel stupid. And so getting past that sense of vulnerability of, do I have this right? Am I reading this right? Am I divining the correct meaning of this poem? And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how you help people work through that sense of not being experts, you know, especially people who are used to performing in other arenas at a very high level, so they can stay with it long enough to get to the heart of the matter.
That's a very rich and good question. Thank you for that. And the opportunity to think about it out loud is really exciting, because I think what I love about poetry is that it's kind of the punk of art, in that there's not any money to be made in poetry. Like, no one's in it for the money. And so it's kind of a pure art in that way. And I think that there are no mistakes when you're being creative. There's journey, and sometimes you're moving through something that might not be as fluent or eloquent as something else, but every time you're being creative, you're learning something about how you are when you're being creative, and that is valid. I also think feeling vulnerable is really valid, and we talk a lot about it being okay to be vulnerable, and actually to make it legitimate. We are vulnerable. We're mortal. We're fallible. We make mistakes. I mean, being human means essentially we've got mistakes embedded in us. Our heart will stop and break and do all the things, and that's okay. So I'm really interested in our reticence to be vulnerable, because I think it speaks to that kind of perfection. And as we know, perfection is brutal. There are different vocations where perfection is necessary, and that is a totally different conversation. But when you're in a creative kind of pursuit and you're being creative, first of all, I think it's important to note that when you encounter the blank page or the unknowing that you're talking about that brings up that vulnerability, our old brain kicks in, and we see that blank page as a tiger. Like, we become afraid because it feels fearful. So we are not, you know, we're not making those decisions, you know, the brain thing. We're not making those decisions, the creative decisions. We just have to kind of understand that the fear that we're feeling, which is vulnerable, sometimes critical, who are you to write? What do you have to say that's worth anything? All those voices, if we can train ourselves neurologically to understand that that's just the swamp, and it means that we're on the right path, then we just learn that we have to move through it. And that's why writing practice is a practice, because Every day I have to move through it. I get better at distinguishing, oh, that's the swamp of my brain warming up, but I have to get through it. And then the research on creativity has been getting more and more exciting, but they're finding that we often take our first idea just to relieve us of that fear. And part of practice is to keep sitting there not knowing until like the sixth, seventh idea is when you start cooking imaginatively, when you're making associative leaps and you're thinking in a creative way rather than in a kind of logical, this is that kind of not so imaginative way, but in a playful way. And by play, you know, I mean a serious play where you're not engaged in outcome, you're engaged in the actual process of making something. And you forget about time and yourself, and you're just making something. And that forgetting of time and yourself, it's very anti-capitalism, it's very not 9 to 5. And it needs the time as at the an end time as well. Like you can only do it for say 2 hours, 3 hours max, and then you have to walk, you have to move, but it's good to have an end time as well. So if someone's starting out, I'd also say have a little like a time constraint, an hour, just to see what happens.
You know, one of the things that you said that just resonates so deeply with me is that reframing of our relationship to whether it's to vulnerability, whether it's to uncertainty, thinking of uncertainty. This is, I think, often a problem in medicine. You know, we are so conditioned early on to think of uncertainty as something that we must obliterate. It's bad, it's negative. Mm-hmm. And reframing it as something that, as you say, gives rise, you know, to or is an intrinsic part of a process seems like a very fundamental shift that framing is very permissive and helpful to people, I think.
Well, and I think it's interesting what you say, because I think as soon as we make our minds up, like we're more interested in knowing what's going on than actually just attending to what's happening, then we close down all the little peripheral kind of clues or observations we're making if they don't support what we think we know. And we lose a lot of really valid and crucial information. I'm thinking medically, you know, just like the holistic, like, let me just be in this space and just consider what's going on. And poetically, the same. If I just think, okay, I'm going to write a poem about the pandemic, then everything that's come out of the woods creatively for me, I'm going to not use because that's not on my agenda. And so my practice to keep it sustainable is to like just be open and see. It's more a practice of curiosity and see what happens and willing to take the risk of not knowing how it's going to turn out and doing it anyway.
I think that framing, one of the things I love about how you put all that is it just leads us so naturally into this question of how can the arts, the creative arts, help our future physicians, our future nurses, our other allied healthcare colleagues, how can they help them be more attuned, more human, more humanistic? And I think you really highlight a few ways in which the similarities of that creative process, you know, unfortunately, so many people are trained to believe or come to medicine with the idea that it isn't a creative pursuit. And then factually, I think you've just really highlighted what the commonality of the process really is when you're in the zone, experiencing it at its best.
Yeah. Being in the zone. That's that exactly. Yeah. And I think we all know when you're in your groove, you know how that feels. And that's what we're after. Being in the groove.
So to pivot for a moment, you have done some writing around mental health. Mental health is a subject that's very close to your heart and something that you have a vested interest in promoting dialogue and creativity around. Could you tell me more about that and how that manifests in your life?
Sure. I wrote a book about a specific case where in Boston, a doctor was prescribing off-brand psychoactive drugs to a child. And I was intrigued by that. And just the whole where business meets healing. I was very, especially with mental health and how little we know about mental health, our brains and mental health. So I'm fascinated just at frontiers of how little we know, like how the human brain is like the bottom of the ocean. We just don't know how it works. And we create medicine to hopefully, you know, living with mental health issues is so challenging. And we're just starting to understand, you know, being able to see the whole picture and see what that person, meeting the person for what they need rather than what we think they need is a huge shift. And you know, creating a sense of autonomy and interdependence and support and all of that. And having said that, you know, I've been teaching, you know, at Dal for 13, 14 years now. And in the last couple of years, I've seen a big rise in my students in like the levels of anxiety and depression they're experiencing and how what they're bringing to the classroom. And so for me, like to teach a creative practice and to talk in a safe enough way in a classroom, we need to talk about that. And I think, especially with the pandemic, the wars, the housing crisis, the racism and white supremacy, like all the things that have been going on, I think the next pandemic will be mental health. I think it's just something we're going to have to be able to talk about and get rid of the stigma. And the stigma is very deep, and it runs, it's tricky because it's a wildness, mental health. We don't quite know what we're doing. So I think having a creative practice, any kind of practice that promotes a kind of exporting any kind of smoke in your body that's not leaving you feel good and transforming it into something else is a positive experience. And it's also, it amplifies natural confidence. It's like, I am not this, I'm experiencing this. And therefore I can put it on paper and make it do something else. And when I do that, when someone does that, when they're generous enough to share their experience, then someone who hears that poem or that story or even just that bit of writing relates to it in a way that's can be transformative in their lives because it's made legible something that they hadn't had words for. And that's really empowering. Our brains are narrative machines. We want the story. We need the words for what we're experiencing. And I think part of getting rid of the stigma around mental health is talking about it more and understanding how we all have people in our lives who endure mental health issues.
I love how you just framed that. That felt so vivid to me for a moment. Because we've all had those moments, right, where there's a poem we look back on and it just gives us a chill. It's associated with a particular moment. It's like a flashbulb memory. And you just made me think of it now as, you know, there are the words and the setting is the music. You know, it's like when everything sort of comes together, the poetry becomes the lyric and the music becomes all the conditions in our life become the music, the part
trauma.
That's sort of giving it that extra animation and layer. So I want to talk to you for a few minutes about writing about trauma. And I know you have edited an anthology of writing of those who have experienced sexual assault. And I wonder if you could share some of your thoughts just on first pass when it comes to the idea of writing about trauma, maybe what it is that we're trying to accomplish, what some of the principles are, and what some of the lessons that you've learned editing work, either of your own or of other individuals about traumatic experiences. What can you tell us about that?
I think this experience, the pandemic, the wars, like this is trauma. I think we're collectively experiencing trauma. So I think being trauma-informed is a really important way of thinking in these challenging times. For me, the way I see writing serving someone who's kind of navigating through a traumatic experience or memory is how writing can reclaim the narrative, re-narrate the experience so that there is dignity back for the person who had the experience. So often is really good. Trauma and shame kind of go hand in hand. And the person who endures trauma often thinks it's something they've done. It's their fault somehow. And I think that the process of writing through those experiences offers space for the person to understand the complexities and dynamic of how trauma works and how those memories of, you know, how little power they had when something traumatic was happening to them, and how creating a sense of homecoming for themselves is the first radical act of healing. And breaking your silence, as you know, is the second radical act of healing. And so sharing how that reclamation looks for you and how each of us, you know, no matter like how many books on the shelf are about specific types of trauma, we all have to speak our own truth. So someone can't do it for us. We can hear other people's work and feel the homecoming, like you said, that kind of the thrumming of being recognized or being included or being heard or seen, which is so valuable. Like it's like so potent, but also doing it yourself, you know, like writing your own truth out and doing that work of reclamation of your own dignity and sense of worth and sense of powerless in that situation, I think is really, I keep saying transformative, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. it is transformative. The nature of it mm-hmm. is transformative, and it's not mm-hmm. an easy thing to do.
You know, that piece that you emphasize of finding a locus of control, first of all, so resituating yourself in terms of the experience, I think, has also powerful applications for us in terms of how we take histories, how we talk to patients about their experiences, and giving them those invitations to inhabit different vantage points is sort of one of the things that you make me think of. And the other is this idea, you know, and it's again one of the really infinite places where there are intersections between the so-called evidence-based, science-based realm and the creative arts, that there is this body of literature of all these things. You know, we talked about the ways in which observation and looking at things in a cultivated way actually changes the way that your brain is structured and functions. And then there's also literature, which I would suspect you're familiar with too, basic principles of how writing about traumatic experiences actually influences our immune function in a positive way, that it actually can change the way some of our T cells function and the way that whether we're likely to get a cold virus that we're inoculated with in the period of time after that. So it just strikes me that so often we seek that legitimacy, you know, from science to say, oh, see, it's valid, as opposed to just trusting ourselves mm-hmm. to know that we do this and it's the right thing, that humming, that thrumming, as you said. We don't need to seek out that other validation, and yet we're sort of addicted to that in the world in which I practice medicine, you know? So I wonder how that resonates yeah. with you, or if that strikes you as something that you see particularly from your work as an arts professor.
Well, I hear the word I hear in that what you just said was addicted. And I think that there is, you know, I'm going to sound like all woo-woo, but I think that we're living a lifestyle and a speed of life that is pretty unsustainable. I think, you know, the 9-to-5 job and have, you know, coming home and having to cook and do the homework. And like, I just think we're all yeah. burning out. And I think we're like getting to the point where we're understanding work-life balance. And that's a big thing that I think about. But as far as like the other thing you mentioned was body, the T cells and not getting a cold. And so much of creativity begins with breath, with body. And I think we're mostly living in our heads, you know, at work. We're thinking a lot, but we're not feeling. I mean, feeling emotional intelligence, it's tricky. It's complicated. It gets messy. And so some of us just like, oh, no, I don't want to go there. And I think creating space where there's no bad feelings, it's all good. And you're putting it on page, and you're putting it on the page because we know that when we give ourselves space to think imaginatively, it's how we can leave those habituated routine ways that we narrate ourselves and our identity that keep mm-hmm. us kind of trapped in a kind of rudimentary way of thinking mm-hmm. about ourselves. And so getting past our knowing into the unknowing, into a new way of being that actually increases our sense of vitality, which has a direct impact on our body in many ways, I think is another great argument for having a creative practice, so that you're right at the edge of what you know, and you're just peering ahead, seeing what mm-hmm. else can happen. How else can I say this without like referring to the same old ways of saying it? And so I'm really interested critically, research-wise, into the imaginative way we think and what that brings to the situation. And I'm thinking that reality and imagination mm-hmm. is on a spectrum. And we've had a severe dose of reality mm-hmm. in the last 2.5 years. And we're all going to need a little bit of vitamins yeah. of imagination to just be aerated and feel our kind of, our you know, our vitality and our sense of, you know, like radical mm-hmm. optimism, not just, oh, going to get better, or they're going to go back to normal, which won't ever, I think, happen. But that optimism that is deeply wired in our ability, our confidence in our ability to make something mm-hmm. from nothing.
Oh, I love that. I love that.
Yeah, I think that's yeah. where we're at. So I think, you know, if you can kind of look in your days and write down five things, that is not just the beginning of writing five things. That is the beginning of waking up back into your world and caring about it. And we know that observation leads to care and a relational way of being, which is win, 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 win. And
you know, again, the way you phrase that, I have never thought about it from this perspective. You're talking about, if we were speaking about it in the medical context, we might call it cognitive reframing. So trying to find new things, right? But reframing, cognitive reframing, as an inherently creative process, as opposed to just one with an endpoint of trying to change the way you think and be moved from maladaptive to adaptive. I mean, in itself, that is actually a very radical and amazing suggestion. Like, that also, I think, gives us a framework for saying, here's something we already do that we call science. And in fact, it's not just science, it's a creative process. And that is totally illuminating for me, the way you just phrased that.
Just creating a new narrative, that cognitive, the leap you have to take. So you have to leave your sense of solid ground that you know to arrive at the new thing. And for that moment, you're between. That takes courage, right? That's the vulnerable courage that I think if we were to warm up in terms of like, in our understanding and realize what a significant thing it is to pull off, then it wouldn't be such a bad thing. It would be something that would be like one of our, I think it's one of our superpowers, you know. I think it's like a really important thing.
You know, it also makes me think of something that one of my mentors, he's a clinician, a mindfulness practitioner and teacher and writer, Ron Epstein. And this is something I often find myself sharing with students. It really stuck with me. Ron often talks about the idea that there are two stories to every life. There's a story where we could narrate and say, I've been a series of failures. I've experienced a series of failures. And the other version is, here are the series of the things that I overcame. And it's that same thing again. We say that's cognitive reframing. It's part of the, I'm not a psychiatrist, but it's, you know, part of a therapeutic arsenal of things we can teach to people. But again, it's telling a story from another perspective. It is a creative narrative act.
Absolutely. And I think just shifting perspective or you know, creating a kind of asset framing is again significant. And it's even more significant when you've done the work to actually shift your thinking or understanding that you bring to yourself so that you understand that you're not as bad or, you know, messed up as you think you are, but you're actually pretty brilliant, you know, like radiant and, and worthwhile. And so that when you start beginning that new reframing, it's coming from a green place rather than a desperate place.
This is interesting too, because, you know, in medicine, especially for physicians, but I think to some degree, it's absolutely true of so many healthcare workers. There's this, you know, incredible proficiency for naming deficits. So I can sit down with any medical student or resident and say, what are you not good at? And they can give me a list that can go on till the end of time. But if I say to them, what are your strengths? What is it? What are you secretly proud of? What is a thing that you do really well? You know, that for many people, not only is it harder to generate that list, it's harder to speak that list, to put those words out there, because we've developed this idea that somehow being accurately appraised or insightful, I guess, of our strengths is antithetical to excellence. And, you know, again, it strikes me that this is sort of another way to kill the creative process as you're framing this and as we're wading through this.
I hear you. And I think, especially as women, it's like, well, don't brag, you know, like don't take too much space. And I think there's something about understanding and making legible your strengths. It's more like there's this great story I tell my students at the beginning of every term of how this king tells his community, we're going to have a banquet and I'll supply all the food and the dishes, but you all bring a bottle of wine and we'll put it in a vat and we'll all have a glass of wine. And at home that night, this guy says to his partner, we'll bring water and save our wine. No one will know because everybody will bring wine. And and she was like, oh my goodness, can we get away with it? He said, oh yeah. So on the day of the banquet, the king comes out, there's, you know, food everywhere. Everybody's putting their bottles of wine into the vat and everybody, you know, and there's glasses and they get their glasses of wine and the king makes this beautiful toast about community and sharing and how wonderful it is. And they all take a sip and spit it out because everybody had the same idea and they brought water. Everybody brought water. So I always tell my students, you got to bring wine. You got to bring your good wine. And I think if we were to think of it collectively, it's not so much this is me, but this is what I can offer, then it might be more palatable to be able to name all the ways that we can be radiant, or all the ways that what we can contribute if we were on an island together and we were having to do some, figure some things out in a way that we kind of are. We're all kind of having, I think the next, I read somewhere the next Buddha is going to be a collective. And I think if we were to think like become a brainiac, like Lego, join everything together, I don't think there'd be much stopping us. I think it makes sense for the way that we're making our living now, the 9-to-5, deeply consumered, deeply capitalist, like neoliberal, all that stuff. I think it's really important to keep us siloed, because if we got together, we'd change up a lot of things that aren't working.
You know, one of the things I found myself thinking about as you were talking was also like this toxic role of, I mean, we all know the toxic role of social media in general. We're totally aware of that. Mm-hmm. But there's this interesting pro and con when it comes to social media platforms and poetry and art. You know, there is this, on the one hand, our attention span has been severely truncated. We consume things in such a different way, which there are definitely deleterious effects. But I also just found myself thinking as you were talking about, you know, the possibilities that it does open up for positive consumption, including of poetry, of other people's work, the ways in which it gives us access to people who have traditionally not been upvoted into the canon due to who chose the canon in the first place. I wonder what your thoughts are about, you know, how social media does or doesn't influence your writing, your life, how you read poetry, and how it shows up for you on a screen or not.
Well, I think we all have to be of our time. And I think that social media is, you know, I'd rather be up close to it than ignore it, because I'm really interested in how it can connect. Like you said, there are people who weren't invited to the Western, very white male bodied canon, and we're seeing a diversity of voices that I'm so appreciative of. I think that's no small thing. I also think it's a way, I mean, apart from how we're being, you know, advertising is like searching us out, and like what we're, you know, I have a pair of pink Fluvogs that have been haunting me for 3 years because I looked them up once, you know, every ad, Google ad are these pink Fluvogs, and I'm like, yeah. But I'm also really interested in the relationship with that. It's like, I'm really like, I watch this pair of wolves in New York on a live cam every day because I get to watch wolves, you know, I get to go to lectures at Columbia, and, you know, I think that it's a sharp knife, it's a tool, and I think we always have to remember that we're using it rather than it using us, like anything. And I really am grateful because it's been really lonely these last 2.5 years. And I've really relied on, I'm not on social media a lot, like I'm not on Twitter every day, I'm not that kind of user, but I do dip in just for the company, just to, hey, you know, even if, you know, I just like heart emojis. They make me, they carbonate me in me, you know, like I think it's been really, it can serve us. We know the danger and the dynamic and the doom scrolling and the, you know, the comparing that we do that diminishes our own sense of self. And it very much creates a performative aspect of our identity. Like, this is what I'm doing now. But there's other way. Like, I love following hyperlinks, and I'm reading about like the mantis shrimp. And then the next thing you know, I'm reading about something they found at the bottom of the, like, the research and the things I can, the places I can go on the internet is astounding to me. It's like, so when you dip in and you're willing to like just participate in the kind of way it moves, I think it can be really helpful. Also, I've done a lot of Zoom teaching when I couldn't see my students, but then, so going from masked in person to them back in their bedrooms at home with their parents, but their full faces and smiles. I don't think we have a word yet for when we see each other's smiles again. And I know my eyebrows have been doing so much work with the mask, and I'm like, when I see them smiling, it's so radiant. And it's, and that having that space, you know, like we often met in 2020 when we were first in our isolation. I only had 2 weeks left of class, I think, or three. And we just met just to see each other. We weren't really, we were just so overwhelmed that I think that connection. So I can't imagine where I'd be without, I mean, as much as I zoom, yeah. I'm zoomed out, I get to see my sisters, you know, I get to see my friends who, you know, so I think we have to be of our time. And I think we have to use all the resources we have in meaningful ways. So it's not what we're doing, it's how we're doing it. It's not who we are, it's how we are that needs to shift with the planet, with social media, with each other. Yeah. And that's the next
frontier
revolution.
You know, the other thing that strikes me, you know, I mean, part of what I hear in that answer is, I think, synchronous with so many other things that you've said and we've been talking about. It's acceptance. It's accepting things the way they are. I love that phrase, being of our time. And it also reminds me of the way that, you know, we now do have opportunities to interact, in particular with people we admire, but also with artists, you know, and these little different, I think of from the medical community, folks who are storytellers in microdoses, you know, people who have these huge followings. There are a few in Canada, a few in the States, who just tell stories over three or four posts, you know, little micro moments that they depict. And this, you know, on one hand, a person could say, well, why not write a longer piece for a journal? And on the other hand, a person could say, this is a form. This is its own art form. This doesn't need you to do anything else and beef it up and stick it in a journal where maybe you're going to have word bloat. And it was perfect the way it was.
Yeah. And also, you know, there could be like the critical response of, well, that's indicative of our attention span, like that is becoming, you know, but it's like, yeah, it's true. And I'd rather have a microdose of little brilliance to get me through than being alone in this. So, yeah, I think, you know, like, I think it's hard enough right now if someone's writing or creating, I love how people are curating little memes together. And like, there's like a five slides of bizarre memes that just make me laugh. And I think I'm okay with that. I think that's a different type of vitamin that right now I'm very appreciative of, because, you know, if I'm reading The Guardian and I'm seeing photos of the Ukraine and everywhere else, like not just the Ukraine, there's wars in other countries. It's devastating. And I'm really concerned. This is a question I have for you, is like, what do we do? I think that cognitive dissonance that we're all experiencing, because we have to, this experiencing at the chronic level we are, like, what's going to happen? Like, what do we do with all the things we're seeing and that we can't make it any different? That's to me, that's one of the mental health dilemmas that I think we're going to have to experience.
Absolutely. And I think it goes back to something that we were saying a while ago, you know, about the neuroplastic impact of these things on particularly our kids and their development. And, you know, there's been, of course, endless debate about whether the impact on their brains is related to lockdowns or related to the trauma of the time that we are living through, the inevitable loss and suffering that occurs as a result of a pandemic, as a result of pandemic management per se. It's sort of a zooming out and a bigger picture piece, isn't it? And it's, I think, regardless of what a person believes is the origin, I think where we almost all universally agree is that we have failed our kids, you know, we've failed our elders, and we've failed people of color in so many, so many communities. But I think a piece coming out of this, one of the many evolving aspects, is how have our brains been rewired and what do we know? You know, and on one side, we can look at the way of knowing that what science tells us about brains after trauma, what science tells us about what resilience theories tell us about the factors that are protective. But then I think, as you so perfectly articulate, there are other ways of knowing about responding to this. There are all the bodies of work that were created, you know, in the centuries and time before us, people's responses in artistic form through to other traumas, other wars, other natural disasters and periods of oppression. And I think it's so interesting, isn't it? Because for most of us, unless we are historians at a very high level, we lack the ability to grasp that until it's translated. You know, what happened to creativity in periods of recovery after horrific events in societies? What did people write? We know, you know, a little bit here and there, but what was the response? How was it transformative? How was it restorative? And I think it's one of the reasons why, to me, one of the places I hope we continue to find ourselves gravitating towards is art, the application of art, that dual space that straddles what we know about how we can recover and honor our experiences, and also the magic of what we don't know, but trusting what we know feels good, feels helpful, feels useful, as you articulated.
Well, and how we have different, like we have our brain here, but we have our brain here and our gut brain. Like we have three brains going on, and they all have to kind of align to what we're hearing. I'm thinking, first of all, the climate crisis is a big thing. And I work with teens, especially young writers who are engaging with the climate crisis with their art, because I noticed before I started seeking them out to see how they were doing, I'd go to those Friday marches that the students would organize, and all of them would get up to the microphone and speak in poems. And I thought that was really interesting. So I really wanted to talk to them to see, like, well, what is it about poems? And it feels like that is the only kind of response, you know, the kind of political kind of rage is valid. But we talked about rage. We talked about anger that they're feeling and the deep, deep, profound grief they're feeling because nothing's being done. They feel like nothing's being done. And that they turn to poetry is really interesting. Like, I just, I'm fascinated by that. And I think there's something to that, because I think I heard this story on CBC many years ago about on Tapestry, I think, about these mountaineers, and they got lost in an avalanche and they dug their way out of the snow and they thought they were going to die. They were trudging along and they came to this cabin, and someone had left blankets and matches and chocolate and wine. And for, you know, that night, they managed to kind of find some hope. Like, they warmed up, they figured out where they were. They were figured out how to get contact. And I just think art sometimes acts like that cabin. Sometimes we can arrive at a piece, a poem, or a story, or a painting, any form of art. And it's not sentimental. It's not like, you know, a pat on the head. It's more like, just rest here and remember the humanity of this experience, because we've been here. And actually, the chaos, like, change is actually the only permanent thing. And the more we get used to the fact that, yes, it's terrible now, and it won't always be terrible. It'll be something else. And then it'll be something else. And an art practice is kind of a fractal of that, getting used to the something else. You just keep engaging with the not knowing and moving along anyway, because the next thing might be okay, or the next thing. And it's okay that it's not okay. You're just engaged in how you are when you're creating. And I think that's really important right now, in how, what you're saying about the trauma and everything.
What that also brings to mind is, you know, so much of how we see patients cope, and how we ourselves know that we cope with any sudden traumatic or chronic traumatic experience in our lives. Often things move close in, you know, instead of looking at the scope of the perceived next 30 or 40 years that we always assumed we'd have, suddenly the unit of time changes, and we're looking now at the next day, at the next week, at the next month. And I think to some degree, that's when we've had perhaps all of us our more effective moments at coping with what's, you know, the our personal lows, which we've all had in the last few years. Mm-hmm. Sometimes that the remedy has been, I think in my life anyway, and I've heard this from other friends, to just focus, you know, and it's, of course it's cliche, but to not just to focus on the right now, but to think of it more specifically as changing the unit of time, making it very proximal, or of course, as we always think of in writing, the, you know, driving in the dark, just seeing 6 feet in front of you instead of trying to see off to some distance that actually your eyes aren't capable of taking in or perceiving anyway.
And I think, that doctor driving in the dark with your headlights is so helpful. I mean, you're also talking about mindfulness too, and that the present really is all we have. And that, you know, when we're using our imagination to spice the future with fear or to spice the past with regret, we're misusing our imagination. Or I say to students who come to my office when they're, you know, experiencing a lot of anxiety about the future, it's like, this is an imaginative conversation I say, because we don't know what's going to happen. So if you're going to imagine it in that lighting, let's also brighten it to imagine it in different ways, because it's all possible. So I think sometimes it's a failure of imagination to just go into that, you know, idea that it's not going to be good. And the other thing I'm hearing you when you're talking about your friends and like being in that moment, I remember when Halifax went through the big hurricane a decade ago,
People are so good when we're in trouble. You know, someone, my neighbor fired up his barbecue and was making coffee for everyone. Someone had eggs. Like, people are just so good when we need them to be good. And we don't hear, like, that's one thing when we go back to social media that you were mentioning. It's like, there's a couple of things. I think I'd like to hear more about those moments of good. I want there to be like a forum where it's, and I know there are like Upworthy and stuff, but I think that's, it's, you know, like, let's keep this balanced. And as for balance, it's like, you know, we see all this terror and this violence. And I've been talking to my friends. It's like, well, what's the equal of that, the equivalent of that in goodness? Why can't we see like a group of people land in the Ukraine and say, no, this is not happening in our time. Like, it's mathematical. If that exists, then there should be an equal opposite. And I just want to start naming that. And I think the arts is one of the superpowers for sure. And so are, you know, kitchen dance parties and parades and things. And I just think we have to remember that we have a lot of resources that have kind of been dormant because we haven't been able to see each other. I did a workshop and we all had to wear our masks and we were all in a room and it was about reawakening our imagination in the pandemic to be able to write. And before it started, I just got this sense and said, let's just go outside and stand in a circle so we're safe enough apart, but we can take off our masks and smile. And we did. We made this big circle on the sidewalk and we just like, whoa, and just looked each other. And some of us cried and some dude walked through the circle and went, whoa, I don't know what that was, but it was great. It's just, it's like, I want us to remember that we have that. You know, we have those resources when we gather. We just haven't gathered. So we're super thirsty.
And I think it ties so beautifully into where you began. So we're, because I think part of one name we could use for talking about this is just our inherently wired negativity bias. And that act, as you say, the creative reframing, or whether we call it the therapeutic reframing of experiences through a different lens, you know, does achieve some calibration, especially when it results in gratitude, because we can't hold both those things at once. We're not actually capable of holding two totally different emotional states or thoughts. Maybe emotional states isn't as correct as thoughts at the same time, in the same way that we can't experience a limb that is both hot and cold, or that certainly isn't typical for us. That's a rare experience, fortunately, unless you live in Winnipeg, actually, then it's then it's a normal April day. So it goes. So we have time for one question. Somebody has sent this in. So they've asked for you to share, when you write, do you write for yourself or do you write thinking and knowing that other people will read your work? And has that changed for you in your life as a writer?
Yeah, I used to just write for myself. I think it's like Confucius. You deal with your own stuff, then you deal with your person stuff or the people close to you, then you go into community. I think like I've done the journey of my own trauma and healing, and so I'm not really, I don't need to write for myself. I do write for myself, but I don't publish that writing. So if something happens to me, if I lose someone important to me, I will process with poems because I'm a poet. If I was, you know, a carpenter, I'd be banging nails and making a shelf or something. But I'm a poet, so I work through my stuff, my life with poems. But I'm really interested in creating a space with words so that it is like that cabin I talked about, when a reader can come into it and feel confident that however they're reading it, it's okay. And so I work with the words I'm writing and also the silence I'm curating around the words, which is the very big difference between poems and prose or narrative, is that poems are kind of all about the silence. And so I'm writing more as a kind for the future, I think. I think I'm always writing in the future thinking, what can I say about this? And how can I'm really interested in surprising myself. If I put words together that I don't expect and they kind of combust into something I didn't anticipate, if I'm surprised, I'm hoping someone else will be surprised. And it's kind of like Buddha said, you know, with one candle, you can light a lot of candles. And I think I've been lit by poems. You know, poems saved my life when I was a teenager. I had, like I said, a crooked house and not a lot of really good guidance. And for some reason, I turned to poems and just found family. And I just kind of like try to give back to that. Like I know when I was young, poems were my company. So I just try to make good company for people.
Well, we are almost out of time. You have been just amazing company this evening.
You too. What a great conversation.
It's been amazing. Between you've made me think about so many things in so many different ways. I'm going to ask you one final question. Mm. So we have so many different people who listen to this show. We have healthcare providers, physicians. We also have artists and just people who do all kinds of different things. But I want you to think about the physicians for a moment. And I want you to think about my prescription pad. And if I want to invite either my patients, my friends, my colleagues to begin to harness some of the power of this work, we've talked generally about what people can do to begin to write, the looking at five things. What else should I write on that prescription pad? How else can we help the people around us find a door into a world that might have been part of their lives when they were younger, as you described, and maybe they're looking for a way back in? What's on that prescription?
That's a great question. And that could be like a whole topic. I think the first thing that comes to my mind now when I'm thinking, like when I let the question dissolve into my heart, I think it would be listening, active listening. And I think active listening is very different than just waiting or anticipating or plucking out the things you want to hear that support your idea that you've already arrived at. It takes practice to deeply listen to someone, and listening, you know, so much of what someone's talking is going on in their body, their body language. So, you know, actively listening is kind of widening and opening your ears and your eyes and everything to properly engage meaningfully to what someone is saying to you. And I think we lose that because of the hurry we're in. I think it's like there's many things that are endangered besides, you know, wolves and the animals that are in, you know, I think real darkness. I mean, I wrote a book about how we can't find darkness. I drove out outside Halifax to see the falling stars and had to drive like for 2 hours because there was, you know, security lights on everything and I couldn't find darkness. And I think listening, you know, like I've done a lot of it because I, you know, a poet, you know, who someone's listening all the time, I find myself not a great listener all the time. So it's been something that I've brought myself back to is listening. Also, I mean, this is like 12 minutes of meditation is a game changer. Like just breathing in and out and just understanding how the brain works. I think when you're in you're doing such valuable and essential, crucial work that I think radical self-care is another. So active listening and radical self-care, because I think giving yourself permission to be tired and to not know, to not, you know, what did Yo-Yo Ma say about being perfect? It's not very communicative. And I think there's something to that. So not knowing and being okay with that and just, you know, holding yourself with care, I think, and feeling the feelings. Yeah. It's just plugging back into your acoustic self rather than the electric rush of self that our jobs asks us to be. It's hard though. I don't know how you do it.
You know, I think one of my favorite things about what you just said is that I so often talk about those same things from a scientific or a medical perspective, and you have tied them all back to art and creativity and heart and soul. And that is just magnificent.
Full circle. Here we go.
Sue, it has been just incredible to spend this hour with you. It's flown by, and I'm going to find myself thinking about so much of what you said and the way you have framed things for me. So no surprise that a poet would do that, but you've just done that in a spectacular way. Thank you so much.
I'm so grateful for this conversation and this opportunity to talk to you. You've been an amazing conversationalist. You've asked me some really, really good questions.
And I just want to encourage everyone who has the opportunity to be with us here this evening or is listening to us subsequently on a podcast to check out some of your incredible work. So many books I've read, your two most recent collections of poetry, they are gorgeous. So hopefully that is one more thing we can write on our prescription pad for the folks who have joined us for this evening. But Sue, thank you so much. And As we end this hour, I would like to say one more time, thank you so much to the generous sponsorship that we receive from the Canadian Medical Association, MD Management, and Scotiabank. They all make this series possible and allow it to sing. And also so grateful to our team at the National Arts Center who bring our series to the digital platform. And our hope is that by this fall, we will be back in person at the National Arts Center. I'm so grateful that you joined us for this last hour. The series is Arts, Medicine, Life. I am Dr. Jillian Horton. Take care of yourself, and hopefully you can join us next month when my guest will be the legendary Dr. Nancy Olivieri talking about the moral imperative of advocacy. Thank you so much, and good night.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca, or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.